Okay, well, welcome to Simply Reliable. My name is Tom Coffin. We're going to talk about contacts and user privileges today. And we'll start off by clicking on the black tab where you see the word contacts. If we select that, you'll see a row of tabs will come up below it. So we've got the first row, the second row, and sometimes there's a third row. So the first thing would be, let's add a new contact. And you do that by over on the right-hand side, you'll click the button New Contact. And that'll bring you to the contact edit screen. And in here, we can put a person's first name. So I'll just put in a fictitious person here. Try and spell it right. And I'm putting in a prospect, for instance. If it's a company, you could put a company name up here. And you can search, of course, by the company name or by the person's first name. A salutation being, this is a Mr. If they've got a title, you can click here and put the title in. If you want to put other contact information in, like job site and primary contact, there's a place to do that. However, there is something called related contacts, which we'll get to later, which I think is a better way to find that information out. And we'll talk about the linking to Outlook here in a little bit. So the bill to address, this is where you're going to send the invoices. So we'll give them an address here. And you can use your tab to move through these items in this specific spot. The next one that you see down the row or column is a secondary place for additional addresses. And in here we could put things like office, summer residence, winter residence. If you click on edit, it'll bring up what we call a value list, and then you can add additional places to that. And this is simply for reference, so if you want to keep track of different places. Again, my preference is to create a main contact for the main person. And then if they have other residences, create a residence for that person separately and then relate the two. That way it's easier to track what's going on with the different jobs. Now at the bottom of this column, there's something called a ship to. And the ship to, of course, this could be a manufacturer, it could be a vendor, it could be a consumer. If this is a consumer, the ship to, if you have a different address that you're working on, let's say the project that you're installing the system on is in one area, but you're sending the bills to their still existing house. You can put their existing house here at the bill to, and you can put the new job site in the ship to. And you'll notice there's a lot and a unit number that you can put in there as well. If there's something in the ship to that's different than the bill to, the ship to will show up on work orders, and the bill to will show up on invoices. Back up top here, we've got email. So you want to put their email in there if you have it. If there's a website, let's say this is a company and you've got a website you're going to put there. Now, when you're putting the website information in, if you click here, you'll see it's already got the HTTP www. So you can then put their specific information in. The system will automatically create a contact code for the customer. And we use that contact code just as a pointer, knowing which contact this might be. Under the phone section, be aware that most of the things that you're going to print, like invoices, work orders, purchase orders, will print the first two phone numbers that are here. So in this case, this is a consumer, so I might want to have the home phone and, let's say, the cell there. If this is a business, I might want to have the business phone and the fax number there. We'll go ahead and put some numbers in. Okay. That's how you add a new contact. Once you've added the contact, you typically want to classify what type of contact they are. So if you click on the second row down, you'll see a button called Classifications. If we click on classifications, this opens up a screen so we can start defining kind of what we're going to do with this person. If we click on edit, you'll notice now these boxes have turned white and we can actually make choices inside them now. So first of all, what type of contact are they? And your screen may look different than mine. I've gotten rid of some. I've put some spaces in. And the way you do that to edit any of these is you click on edit list, which will bring up this list here, pull the list all the way down, and then click edit again. And now we've got a value list that we can add types of contacts to or get rid of. The ones to be very cautionary about is you don't want to get rid of any of this employee section. And the reason for that is because if you get rid of current employee, then no one can be an employee, so therefore you really can't get inside the system, which would be a bad thing. So we're going to make this Mr. Jones here purchasing a home. Next, you'll see something called disciplines. And the concept here is that if you've got a subcontractor, for instance, you can click subcontractor, and you might list what disciplines this person does the subcontracting for you. Prospect and customer type. We have lead, prospect, client, and opportunity. Essentially, currently the system supports prospect and client. So we'll make this person a prospect. We know we're going to do a proposal for them. What status are they? Is it done? Are they active, interactive, or dead? What source did you get this contact from? Maybe you got this contact from one of your favorite builders. So you click on that builder, and again, you can edit the list. And if you have multiple offices, you can choose which office they're from. You can also assign a salesperson. So we're going to assign a salesperson. I'll assign myself. You could even assign engineering, installers, programmers, whatever is appropriate. And then we can choose whether we want to link this contact to Outlook. So I'll click Link Contact to All Users. And now that makes it available so that anybody can sync this person with their Outlook. If you want to make this person part of the holiday mailing list, there's a button over here that you can click. And now when you run your mailing list report, they'll be part of it. Once you're done with that, you click Submit. And that adds that contact. Now, multiple contacts can be added through our download sheet. So if you go to simplyreliable.com and you go to support, when you get there, you'll type in for the username SRS, and then for the password 54321. Okay, so now we're on the support section. If you come over here to downloads, you will see data import files. If we click on the data import file, it's going to download that. And when you open it, you'll see an SRS contact data form. So you can fill in all the information on that form. Or for instance, let's say you're using QuickBooks or some other program. You can push your data out to what's called a CSV or comma separated values and then copy that information directly into this Excel sheet and then import it. And the way that you do the importing is you're going to go to My SRS, Preferences, and then Contact Preferences, and you'll see Import Contact Data right here. Likewise, if you need to move the data out and you want to take the information somewhere else, you can also export contact data right here. So when you click on that Import Contact Data, it's going to ask continue, download, or cancel. So if you don't want to do it, you'll hit cancel. I went to the site manually and clicked and got the download already. If you have not done that, you can simply click download. It'll open your browser, go out and find that and open it. Or if you already have it filled out, you click continue, you'll go find it. It'll ask you where it is. I'm going to cancel out of that. And then it'll import all that data. Now, you can import data from your Outlook program as well, and the first thing that you've got to do with that is you've got to make sure that you're in there as a contact. So, okay, so I'm already in here. And I've got a number, so, and I'm set up as an employee, so that will allow me to then connect back and forth. And the way that we do that is we're going to go to Contacts, and then Contact List. And, of course, choose your name. And as I said, there's that number right there. So you want to write that number down for yourself. So in my case, 202-2413. And then you're going to go to your Outlook. And I don't think I have Outlook on this machine. And in your notes section, this is Outlook Express, but I'm sorry, I clicked message there. Let's go to contacts. Let's see if I do have Outlook on here or not. I changed this machine so we could record this again because my other one's too slow. There we go. Yeah. Bear with me just a second. Okay, so now we're on a machine that has Outlook on it. So you find yourself inside Outlook, and inside there, inside the notes section, you want to create what I have written right here. So you've got a parentheses, capital SRS, dash, capital link, capital L, small INK, dash, and then whatever your number is. And the purpose of that is when you log into SmartOffice and you go to do that Outlook sync, it's going to look for that number inside your Outlook to say, okay, this is the person I'm syncing with. So that way everybody doesn't sync and get the same thing over and over again. Okay, now we'll go back to the machine. Okay, so when you want to actually do the import-export, you'll click on My SRS, and there's a button called Outlook Link. And I obviously don't have these two linked up, but we'll walk through the concept of what's going on here. So your choices are you can sync contacts, you can sync appointments, and you can sync emails. Syncing contacts, it's going to look for, this is, again, I'm signed in as the administrator, so you'd want to be signed on as yourself. So Tom Coffin would normally be there. And it's going to look at the contacts in Outlook that are linked to you and the contacts linked to the user inside of SRS. It's going to bring those up on this side for SRS and on this side for Outlook. So if there is a difference between the two, you can choose to copy all SRS to Outlook or copy all the Outlook to SRS, and you can fix the discrepancies. There's a sync button and a slow sync button. The slow sync button is going to essentially go down and look at every single record that there is and make sure it matches. the regular sync button is going to look at the name, first name, last name, and if they're there, it assumes it's the same. Okay. The first time you do this, you're going to want to do the slow sync, and then after that, you can just do the sync. The appointments essentially work the same way. It looks for the appointments inside Outlook, it looks for the appointments inside SRS, and then syncs them together and puts the information back and forth. You can also sync emails. So the reason you would want to sync emails is to keep track of information that's going out to specific customers. So the first thing is, in an Outlook mail folder, you need to select which folders are available from Outlook. So you go there and you'll pick the folder name, or type in the name, and then find those folders. They'll populate here, and then you'll essentially point them to a specific client so that you can then resource that later. Okay, deleting a client. If we go back to the client we started with, which was Jones, so I'll take Stuart Jones here. If I click, now we want to be in the contact info screen. Sorry, contact detail screen. And once you're there, click the edit button. And then this is the button that you'll click to delete this contact. Now when you delete a contact, there are some safeguards there to make sure that the wrong things don't happen. So if you click delete this contact, what's going to happen is this is going to come up and say, you sure you want to delete Mr. Stuart Jones, and here's his address. If you say OK, it's going to bring you to this screen. And as you can see, I don't have any documents on this screen for this person at all. So to delete him, not a big deal. But I might. You might have items there, and if you do, then you can change your mind, or you can say, no, I want to delete them, I don't really care, and go ahead and do it. So I'm going to hit cancel, and I'm going to show you a contact that's got more information there. So you can see what that might look like. So here's Mary Shelley. I'm going to go to her detail. And we're going to say we want to delete her contact info. Well, now you see this is all filled up. So if I get rid of this, that's a lot of records to get rid of, and I would not be able to trace that history again. So just be aware of that. Okay, let's talk about naming options. And you'll see on this screen there's a button here that says naming options. Again, this is one of the screens you need to click edit in order to change things. Under naming options, we look at how we're going to display the name, how it might come up in a built-to scenario, how we would communicate like an email, how it looks on the proposal, how it goes into the accounting application, and how does it look on a ship to or a work order. So you can make different choices there. If you click into this white box, here's your choices, last, first, company name, etc. You want to be aware that that the way you put this this name in is the way it's going to populate. So for instance, if you're working with QuickBooks, if there's a space between the word Mary when you added that into the contact info page, then it may not match up with QuickBooks because that space wouldn't be there. We've talked about classifications. Let's talk about an employee. So if we have a contact information, or a contact person, I'll use myself again as an example. And we open that up. And I want to make this person an employee. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to classifications, which we did before. Click Edit. You'll see I've chosen Current Employee. Now, once I have chosen that, I can now go to the Employee section. And here I am right here. If I select this, now I want to set up and tell the system essentially what does this employee do. And where this becomes important is under the Work Order section. So first of all, every employee is always, you always select all for. That way, if we're filtering by all, every employee shows up. Then the next question is, okay, what else do they do in the system? Are they a salesperson? Do they do engineering, programming, et cetera, et cetera? So you'll select those items. We have a page called Contact Notes. And Contact Notes provides a couple things for us. It provides us some search options, where you see custom options right here. I have zone 1 equals bedroom, DVD upgrade, security monitoring. If those are checked, again, click my edit button. If those are checked, then I can do a search for all the people that have security monitoring, for instance, and they'll populate that search field. There's a section up here for travel directions. So this will actually print on the work order in the description section. We've provided a place for important notes that does not get printed anywhere. So if you have something private that you need to share about this specific contact, you can put it in there to be available to anybody in the system that can see it, but it won't ever go on a piece of paper or a report anywhere. The custom contact data section, this is designed to cover things that just weren't covered in the software, but you still need to keep track of. And I always use the example of gate codes, alarm count numbers, satellite numbers, IP addresses, things like that. So you've got a blank section over here where you can click and you can type in whatever you desire. These 12 sections that are here are set up under preferences. And we'll go back to preferences here in a little bit and show you where those come from. Next button is additional info. And additional info provides us a place for additional notes. But also, probably the most valuable part about this page has to do with alternate build to, and also has to do with vendor specific information. So I'm going to show you a couple different things here. Right now, I have myself linked to Best Custom Homes, and therefore I have them as the alt build to. And what that means is when I create an invoice for myself, the invoice is actually sent to Best Custom Homes. Well, the way that you do that is through related contacts. So if we click on the button related contacts, you'll see here's Tom, you see Best Custom Homes and Brown, and we can add additional people to this. And these are called the players that are related to Tom. So I'm going to pick another one like do Ben Simpson here. Okay, so this has added Ben Simpson. Now I have to tell the system what the relationship is. So if I click where it shows Ben, we'll make Ben, let's say, the architect, and Tom is the client. Okay, now having done that, if I'm doing a project for Tom here, I can now print a report, and we'll get into more reports later, but I'll show you this one now, called the Related Players Report. And this shows me all the players on Tom's project. I can print that out, hand it to the installer. If they've got any questions, they know who to call. Here are the people for them to call. So it's a nice way to kind of reduce some phone traffic back to the office. Additionally, under related players, is something called projects. So in order to show you projects, I want to pull up someone else. I'm going to go to contacts again, and I'm going to pull up Best Custom Homes. Okay, so now Bob the Builder from Best Custom Homes is our active contact here. And if I go to related players on him, and I click on projects rather than players, now here are all the projects having to do with this specific builder. So if I'm going to have a meeting with this builder, I might want to go to my reports, print related players, and here's all the jobs I have going on with that builder. So I can have a pretty good conversation about the different projects that we were involved in. I want to go back to the additional info, but in order to take you there, I'm going to show you a manufacturer. So let's say we choose Lutron. Okay. Thought Lutron was in there. Okay, there's Control 4. So I'm going to select Control 4. Now if I go to Additional Info on Control 4, this is where you're going to select the lead time for the parts that you order and the vendor payment terms for this specific manufacturer or vendor. So if you click in the box, it'll give you a drop down. You can pick whatever days are appropriate, or you can type something else in. Same thing with the vendor payment terms. We can select whatever's in there, or we can click on edit and then add additional ones in there if we need to. And that's how the system knows when you need to order things. Now you've seen a couple of different things happen when I search for a person. So let's go to Shelley. If I click in the blue, this takes me to the contact activity page. If I click over here under detail, it takes me to the contact info page. So we're going to go to the contact activity page and talk about what's happening here. So here this gives me all the information about how to contact and get a hold of Mary Shelley. Up here you see a section called communication. This is a great feature. Everyone in the office has the ability to get into SRS, and they have it open all the time. When the phone rings, let's kind of go through a scenario. The phone rings, it's Mary Shelley, and she's looking for Tom. I'm not in the office. So the person answering the phone can simply come here to New Note, and then type in what's going on. So Mary called and wants to discuss a home theater. We also give you a subject line. And if you click on the subject line, click on the black space there, you'll see there's a list of choices here. If you don't see one that you like, again, you can pull this down, you can edit and create what you want. Well, I want to use lead, so I'll click on lead. And then I want to CC this. So if I click on CC, I can make sure that I'm logged in as administrator, so I'll click on that so you can see that. But maybe I also want to make sure the boss knows that's going on, and of course then get it to Tom. So now that communication's happened. I didn't have to leave a voicemail. I didn't have to send an email, just a couple of things jotted down. Now when Tom comes back in the office, he's going to select My SRS, My Activity. And now you'll see right there, there's a lead. Mary called and wants to discuss a home theater. Great. So I select that. That's what she wants to do. So now I'm going to call Mary. So I can call Mary, get a hold of her, and we set up an appointment. And in order to do that, I'm going to click on New Appointment. It's going to ask you, is that with Mary Shelley? Yes, it is. Now, you'll notice this is a work order task list. So those of you who've used the system before are used to using this for jobs and for installers and things like that. There's no reason in the world you can't track your sales team the same way. So the description here is meet with Shelley to discuss theater. And I've called Shelley, and so I'm going to send Tom out there. So remember I talked about the filtering here. This is selected on all right now. If I click on that box, everybody in the company will populate. If I change this to sales, now just the people who sell will populate. So click on Tom, and he's in there. I'm going to send him out there on Friday, June 5th. And I'm expecting he'll be out there about 9 o'clock and should take about an hour and a half. Here you've got appointment type. Under the appointment type, right now we just have installation, service, punch list, and meeting. Well, I want to track sales on this as well. So I'm going to put sales into that value list. Okay, so there's a sales meeting that I've set up. I can now email it to the staff, and I can email it to the contact. And both of them will know what's happening. Before Tom goes out to that meeting, I want to send my engineering guy out to measure the room so Tom will have a little better idea what type of screens we're talking about. And that's a good example of project tasks, which is the next section under activity. So these are tasks that are not specifically assigned inside of proposals. They're kind of outside that realm. So it might be sending someone out to measure something, running to pull a permit, washing the trucks, you know, whatever you want to use. So I'm going to click New Task. It's going to ask me, is it for Mary Shelley? Yes, it is. So I've got the New Task here. We'll select it. And then in order to edit it, we want to click the Edit button. And now you see the screens have turned white. The administrator is already assigned to it. I want to also assign Tom. So they're both on there. And actually, I want to assign this to Uber. And we'll say, go out and measure Mary's room for screen sizes. You can give it a category. In this case, it's engineering. You can set the priority up. It's very, very important. And they've got to go there tomorrow. To get it done. And then any other comments you might have or any history you might want to put in that section as well. Same thing now. When they check my SRS and they go to my activity, here's my to-do list. And you'll see there's Mary Shelley with her to-do list. Okay, let's talk about preferences. If we go to My SRS and we go to Preferences, click on System, and then Contact Preferences. This is where we talked about that custom contact data. Here's where you define those. You can also define the naming options in this section. You can define the naming options so that you can then apply it to everybody from here forward or back. So you, again, the same choices here that you saw earlier. And once you're in there, that's the way you want them to all be, you simply click Apply to All Contacts, and that will then change your preferences on that. Selecting an existing contact, you would simply click Contacts, and then you'll see right here there's a quick search. So I can search by first name, by last name, or by company. And this is used, this quick search is used not only in the contacts, but it's used under proposals and products as well, and projects. So if I'm searching for someone I'm not quite sure what their name is going to be, I can type in just S, for instance. And it's going to bring up all the people that have to do with S. There are a couple of other different types of reports that can be had. We talked about the related player reports. There's also the mailing labels report. So here's the mailing label for all those S's. So you can then print this to labels and then print it out. Put it on your envelopes. There's a client profile. So if I go to Contacts and I pull up Mary Shelley again, make her active, and then we go to our Reports section. If I click on Client Profile, it'll now show me all the documents, all the proposals, all the appointments, all the tasks. Pull this down a little bit. And all the invoices out there for Mary Shelley. Uh, And then lastly would be the product search. So this shows me all the products that I've showed, that I have sold to Mary Shelley. It shows me how many, what SKU, what make, a description, even the discipline and the zone that they go in, and what proposal it came from, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, finally, let's talk about user privileges. So the concept of user privileges would be giving specific people in the organization the ability to do things or not to do things. So rights, so to speak. So if I click on My SRS and Preferences, and then System, and then finally User Privileges, it's going to ask you to log back in so it knows who you are, and you need to have administrative capability in order to make these decisions. So we'll type in our password. Okay, so that brings us to this screen. And the first thing you'll see are active employees. Remember we talked about logging someone in as an employee. So these are all the employees that have the ability to be even added to the system. Once you find someone you want to add, you simply click Add to Authorized Users List, and that'll bring the person on this side. Be aware that when you click that button, for instance, I've changed my name to Tom Coffin here, but it says Thomas Coffin on this side. When you click this button and it adds it on this side, it's going to put the name in there, it's going to remove spaces so they're all run together. That then gives you the ability to change your username. So if you're a small company, for instance, and you just want to be logging in as Tom, or if you're a larger company and you want to cover the first name, last name situation, you can do that. If someone forgets their password, the administrator can come back here and reset the password or delete the password if you want to lock them back out of the system. So resetting the word, resetting the password simply sets the password back to the word password, and then they can then set their own password because you don't specifically want to know their password. Now number three, you'll notice that these look pretty familiar. You've got My SRS, Contacts, Communications, Schedule, Engineering, Proposal, Products, Project Management, Inventory, Purchase Orders, and Invoices. And those are simply the items that go across the black tab on the top. And you can choose to give a person capability to get into those sections or not get into those sections. For instance, maybe you want them to have the ability to create a proposal, but you don't want proposals deleted. Maybe you want them to be able to view a product, but you don't want them to be able to edit products and change things like prices. This is also where you would add the offices. So if I click on here, click in the box, and I might type in Avon Lake, for instance. And maybe the second location is New York, and Avon Lake being the primary one. You can choose whether or not they have administrative capability by clicking here. And then you also want to choose whether or not you have the capability to get into SRS Central. So SRS Central is our central library for all the products and the product data that is collected throughout the use of SmartOffice. This is also where you would select the default warehouse. So in this case, the default warehouse for me would be the main warehouse. Once that's all set and it's the way you want it, you're going to click Log Out, and it's going to ask you to log back in. And now if you've made any changes, those changes will now populate. And under My SRS, this is where you can click Change My Password. So if you click Change My Password, it'll bring up this dialog box where you can put a new password in if you choose to. I'm going to click Cancel. Okay, and that completes our training for contacts and user privileges. I'm going to open it up. If you guys have any questions, I'd be more than happy to help you with them.
Tom?
Yes.
David of Media Ranch, I have a question. We have our shipping address is our job site address, and then billing is different.
Okay.
However, whenever we print out work orders, it still goes to the billing address. It shows up on the billing as the billing address.
Let's try that. Okay, so if we go to a contact, let's go back to Shelley here. Okay, so I've got that. Let's put a different address in here. So we'll put lot 101, 32297. Okay, so that's definitely different. Same as primary address, is not checked. So that should be cool. So if we do a proposal, new proposal,
it doesn't even have to be a proposal. It could just be like a service call that we do a work order for.
Yeah, it's working on mine. So give John a call at tech support.
One of the problems we're having is you can't. Can you email this form right here that we're looking at on the screen? This work order form.
The only way to do that is to turn this into a PDF.
Right.
You can.
What we're doing is we're
this
emailing.
This does not work.
Okay. Is that going to work at some point?
Yes.
Okay, because what we're doing is we're emailing we're emailing this to the staff right here, and at this point it doesn't show, it shows the billing address, not the
okay.
Physical address is the problem.
Let me click on here.
Because we're trying to do paperless.
I like that. It's much greener.
Yeah, but it's not giving the correct information is the problem.
Well, we need to get that fixed. Okay.
Okay.
So
that's
having
where
that.
We're having, you know.
I didn't choose any staff. Let's choose some staff here. Since Jonathan broke it, we'll send him out there. Aha.
Yeah.
Okay, I'll show that to Chris today. We'll get it fixed right away.
Okay, awesome. Thank you.
Have you guys done an update in a while?
We did one, I guess, about a month ago. Are we supposed to do those monthly, I think?
Quarterly is probably, you know, enough in most cases.
Okay.
But we've just been doing a ton of work on this last couple of weeks.
Okay.
So let me get Chris to get this thing fixed for you, and then I'll have John give you guys a call and you do an update. There'll be actually a lot of new stuff that you probably haven't seen.
Perfect. And then, David, do you have any other questions?
I did. In regards to proposals, when we create product packages,
mm-hmm.
How can I just have the one line item show the product package and not all the different components that are in that package?
So you want to have something called like the Silver Home Theater, but not show the individual components?
Exactly.
Product package does not support that currently, and I don't see that changing short term. The only way I can think that you could do that would be to turn that into an assembly item instead.
And I have done that as well. How can I hide those items though?
Well, if they're assemblies, they would get hidden anyway.
Okay.
So set them up as an assembly rather than associated.
They're not hiding.
Okay, let's try this. I'll show you. So if we go to products, and I want to create a new product, and I'm going to call this a silver home theater. Okay, so I'm going to make the manufacturer XYZ company. We don't care about that stuff. All right, so under assembly, I'm going to come through here and I'm going to find let's say an Epson projector. So I'm going to add this and that. So put a one there. And let's see if we got some receiver or something like that. Just a couple items here. Okay, so we've got those in there. Calculate. So there's what it's going to sell for. Now let's go to that proposal that we were doing. Take this one. We've got a proposal items. And we'll go to pick product. XYZ, and what was that thing called? Silver Home Theater. Okay, so it's got all the items in there. Let's go to money detail and then let's go push it out to advanced proposal design.
So you have to push it to advanced proposal design? You couldn't just go look and view proposal from FileMaker?
Oh, using the old style?
Yes.
Well, if you're doing the old style, then there's a button that chooses whether you hide assembly items or not.
Where is that button?
Let this load up here. You guys are not using it, advanced proposal design?
We are.
Okay.
But I'm trying to figure it out in both scenarios.
Okay. So here you go.
I mean, this is good as well.
So back over to this section. Let's see, proposals. List this client. Okay, see, this is showing everything, okay?
Yeah.
Now, if we go to style sheets, so classic style sheets. Been a while since I've been over here, so bear with me a second. Show accessories. See what says yes?
Yes.
I want to put that to hide. Okay, now if we display proposal. Gone.
Great, thank you.
Sure. You'll notice we're making it harder to get here. Because we're trying to wean people off of this old style and make sure they're using advanced proposal design. It's got so much more power to it.
Is my understanding correct where when you go to advanced proposal design, it does not talk backwards to FileMaker?
Yes. It sucks the information from FileMaker and then allows you to adapt how it's shown.
But it will not put any information back to FileMaker.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
And there's something new coming out that you'll see shortly as well. It's called language tags. So in your scope of work and your terms over an APD, you can actually now adjust it so you've got bold and you've got plain, decide what text is in or what font is in there, automatically push the customer's name into the contract, things like that. So it's just got a lot more power to it. Okay, any other questions?
I have a question.
Sure.
So let me try to explain this. When we're doing service calls and I'm trying to bill for them, I'm running into some problems when it becomes a multi-day service call. Originally we assume it's supposed to be one day and it ends up being 3 days. So my project manager creates a work order for the guy, he goes, and the next day he's got to create a new work order because he ends up going back the next day to do some more things that get added on or whatever. When I go to bill for this, I can't seem to find a way to combine these work orders onto one invoice. Is there a way to do that or something? I'm having trouble figuring out how to do that instead of sending him three different invoices for the 3 days we went out there.
You could send him a client, what's it called, a client report?
Okay.
Let's see. Client statement, that's what it's called. You could send them a client statement instead, which would combine those things all together.
It combines it. Okay. And so when I'm because we're linked to QuickBooks,
mm-hmm.
will that post to QuickBooks in that manner if I go to post a statement like that, or will it post individual invoices?
It'll post the individual invoices. You'll still have an individual invoice for each work order. But instead of sending him three invoices, you could send him this report instead.
Gotcha.
And then at the end of the report, it's going to show, they owe $12,000 or whatever.
Okay.
So when they pay that, you just apply it to those invoices inside QuickBooks.
Okay. All right. That makes sense. All right. Thank you.
Sure.
That's all I have.
Okay. Anybody else? All right. Well, I thank you for joining me today.
All right. Thanks, Tom.
Have a great day.
You too.